Bargain Wood is one of the most haunting places I've ever known. I've been here a lot over the years, mainly just passing through, but all the same, it's been an important part of my walking life. Being a solitary rambler, I have always found it the perfect place for tranquility. Despite its beauty, very few people ever come here. I've lived in a town for most of my life, so it's hardly surprising that I visit Bargain Wood whenever I get the opportunity. This particular afternoon, I was seeking tranquility here to study Michael Haslett's latest college assignment. It was his story of the last walk that I had taken him on, and here at Whitestone in Bargain Wood was one of the places we had passed through on that walk. So what more appropriate place than to read Michael's tale of our tranquil walk to the Narth. Escape through the valley to tranquility. This is my story, Patrick Leach, of my walk with my friend Michael Haslett to the Narth, one of the fondest areas I've known since I was a lad, and of my boyhood memories of the places we visited along the way.
God, I swear Chepstow gets busier every year. So much noise, what with all the traffic and people running about everywhere.
It's funny, really. You love the countryside so much, but you spend most of your life living in a town.
My life's just worked out like that. I've had to go where the work is. I think it was during my trips to the Narth that I first discovered the joy of escaping to the tranquility of the countryside. It was all so peaceful there.
What is the Narth?
Well, the Narth is basically just a dull little hamlet in the middle of nowhere. I used to go there quite a lot with my family to visit my Auntie Pam. Well, she wasn't really my auntie, just a friend of the family. But as a kid, I always knew her as my auntie. I just loved visiting her because her cottage was surrounded by woodland in which I would just run around and explore. There I would become totally immersed by the tall, silent trees in my own secret little world, with all my worries and troubles lost forever.
So that's our trip for today, is it?
It certainly is, my old son. Yeah, it's a good 9 or 10 miles to the Narth. So that's why we needed to get an early start this morning. The real start of the walk begins here.
All right. Isn't the Wye Valley Walk one of those long-distance, waymarked footpaths?
Yes, it begins here in Chepstow and finishes in mid-Wales in a small town called Rayada, which is near the source of the River Wye.
Have you walked the whole length of it?
Well, I've walked it as far as Hereford, but no further than that. So that's probably about half of it I've done. Today we should be walking a very small section of the Wye Valley Walk. But one day, I should definitely make a point of walking the whole length of it, to Rayada, which should take me about a week to complete.
You told me about this before. It's your old comprehensive, isn't it?
It certainly is, at Kingsmark School, the junior division. The worst years of my life are spent in those shitty classrooms. Anyway, today, this is what we've come to see. This is where we enter Ditchwood.
You know, it feels as though we're entering a whole new world.
Well, it's funny you should say that. It's exactly what we are doing. This is just the first of one of the many spectacular views along the first part of the walk. In fact, the whole of this first section was created by Valentine Morris as part of the Piercefield estate in as late as the 18th century.
Hey Patrick, see that through there? What is it?
Oh, that's Piercefield Mansion. It was gutted by a fire many years ago, and has remained abandoned as it looks now.
You can bet in its heyday, people came from all over the Wye Valley to enjoy the scenery, series of vistas and viewpoints. I expect they were just some of the many attractions laid on for the guests at the house.
These parklands were landscaped by Valentine Morris. A large part on which Chepstow Racecourse now stands.
Is this another of Morris's creations?
No, I don't think so. It's the remains of an old blast furnace used to smelt iron ore, which was found in all small pockets all over the area, even in some of the more inaccessible places deep in the forest. There are many of these in these parts.
What the hell is this? I tell you, it makes a very odd sight, smack bang in the middle of nowhere.
As to what it is or how it got here, your guess is as good as mine. Suppose it's something as a puzzle to me.
I know what it is. I bet you some innocent walker stumbled inadvertently into the woods and a bad-tempered witch turned him into a pillar of stone for his troubles.
Yes. The fork in the path here heralds our imminent arrival at my favourite of Morris's creations.
This walk gets more fascinating the further we go.
This is known as the Giant's Cave. Apparently, it boasted its very own giant at the entrance. That's long since weathered away. Gone as well are the several guns that Morris placed nearby to impress the guests, with the echo across the valley.
This is really quite exciting, as we go for a tantalum in the rock. I've certainly never come across anything quite like it in any other way.
When I was at St. Kingsmart School, the games teachers used to take us on cross-country run through these woods. Mm-hmm. I can remember one incident when the girls were running through the woods. The teacher just totally lost them, and they ended up going as far as Tintern, which is about 5 miles away.
I bet that caused quite an uproar.
We're supposed to come out to the Wyndcliff now, just over the side of the Tintern Road. That's where the 365 steps begins. These woods below the Wyndcliff were famous in Valentine Morris's day for the sound of the hundreds of nightingales that nested there.
All you get now is the sound of the traffic.
Right, we'll just continue up here for a short distance where we come to the next exciting feature. Anyway, here we're going to leave the Wye Valley Walk temporarily and climb the 365 steps, and I want you to count them as we go up.
You bastard. God, I give up. Lost count anyway. In some places, it's hard to tell the difference between a step and a stone in the ground.
You cheat.
I feel absolutely shattered, but I guess it was fun.
Well, if you can just avoid the temptation, stopping here for a rest, just carry on for another 50 yards or so, there's the perfect place for a 10-minute rest. Well, still, we mustn't dally here for too long. We've a fair way to go yet.
How much further is it to Tintern, Patrick?
About spend an hour's walk away.
These woods are quite creepy, really, aren't they?
I was in the Cub Scouts when I first walked through here in Minepit Wood. It was one of just three outings I went on with them. We were a large group of about 30 boys. And I can remember then thinking how creepy it was walking through this wood. 20 years later, here I am back in this wood with you, and I still find it creepy. Well, Michael, you'll be pleased to know it's downhill as far as Tintern now.
Well, I'll be glad of a bite to eat when I get there. All this walking certainly gives you an appetite.
Here we are, Michael. At the other end of this track down there is the lane leading into Tintern. And I could really murder a pint when we get there, I'll tell you.
You do surprise me. Tintern Trail. Why don't we follow this route, Patrick?
I suppose we could do. As long as you're sure.
What do you mean?
There's something waiting for us up there. Something rather sinister.
But the trail, it directs us down here, not up there.
Oh, I know. But if we go up there, we're still following the trail. It's just in the reverse direction, that's all.
Well, what exactly is this sinister place, then?
Well, let's find out, shall we? Don't know why I keep going up there. I have a morbid fascination for the place.
What a very sinister and evil-looking place.
The Church of St. Mary's on Chapel Hill. This place terrified me as a boy.
I wouldn't like to come over on my own, I must say.
There had been stories of black masses being held here after the sign of the pentacle was found chalked on the church floor. Not long after that, the church was destroyed in a huge blaze after a couple of drunken lads came up here and lit a fire to keep warm. One of them was killed. Go on, Michael, let's get out of here.
I suddenly shot out of the churchyard, with Michael following, completely astonished. We continued following the Tintern trail up Chapel Hill.
Why did you suddenly storm out like that?
Sorry about that, Michael. It's just that St Mary's Church has always given me the creep, so I can never stay there for too long.
It's a fascinating old place, though, isn't it? Just occurred to me, Patrick. You don't carry a bag or anything. What happens if you get hungry and you're nowhere near any shops?
Oh, I do plan it out, don't worry. You see, although it's a very tranquil walk outside of the villages, I know from experience that we'll reach a pub by lunchtime. So it's all nicely timed. I took a bag with me when we did that weekend walk last winter through the lost villages, because I knew that we weren't going to come to a pub or a shop on the first day. So I needed to take sandwiches and a small change of clothing as we were stopping over for one night. Now last year, when I walked to Wentwood in the summer, again I knew that I would find the pub by lunchtime. So I didn't bother to take a bag or a rucksack with me that time. I must admit though, I was a bit daft, as I was stopping over one night. So I wasn't carrying a change of clothing.
Good grief, how charming.
Tintern is one of the most picturesque villages in the Wye Valley. The most famous landmark is the Cistercian Abbey. It was founded in 1311 by Walter de Clare and is second only to Fountains Abbey in quality and appeal. Sadly, we have little knowledge of Tintern's history because its records were destroyed during the slighting of Raglan Castle in the Civil War. Much refreshed and invigorated, we pressed on with our journey, with the best part of the walk still to come.
This is the remains of the old Tintern railway station, which as you can see has been imaginatively restored by the Countryside Commission.
It's marvellous, isn't it? The old train coaches are now used as an information centre, and the old signal box is the main tourist information point. What's that pretty looking village over there?
Brockweir. It was once an important port, second only to Chepstow, and has a long tradition of shipbuilding.
It's a very cosy looking place, all its rushing brooks and keys.
Yes, and where there's a port, you'll always find a pub or two. And at its height in the 1820s, there were supposed to have been as many as 16 in the village.
It's a smashing little place. Certainly worth stopping to have a look round.
Yes, well, the next part of the walk is probably my favourite of all. It has a completely different feel from the rest of it.
The Wye Valley Walk continues just over the road, opposite the bridge, and goes on up the hill, through the woods at Coed Bethick, and along towards Bargain Wood. Thank you.
I was always intrigued by the unusual names of some of the places around these parts, like Maryland, Botany Bay, Freedomwood, and Bargainwood. I later heard that the local story was that at one time convicts were held in various villages and would be marched through the woods down to Llanlogo, where they would be taken by boat to Bristol to be transported to the New World. As a last resort, they would bargain for their freedom with their guards as they would come here. Many were successful and would escape off into the woods. And so the locals came to know this as Bargain Wood, and further down, Freedom Wood. Sometimes I would just sit at one of the picnic tables over there for a while and soak up the atmosphere of the woods and imagine what it must have been like back in those times.
So this is your favourite spot on the walk, is it? It's very dark and mysterious here, I must say.
It's a great view, isn't it? On a clear day, you can see Llanlogo down there.
It's certainly a great view of the Wye Valley. But from what I can see of Llanlogo, it looks rather dreary.
Yes, you're right, really. It is dull, but at the same time, very pretty in its own way, because of the way the houses are scattered around it high above in the hillside. I've got a personal affection for Llanlogo, because my great-grandmother is buried there.
I feel a great sense of calmness at this spot, after the oppressiveness of Bargain Wood. It was like the calm after the storm, or the sun coming out from behind a cloud. Oh, I see we're coming out onto another lane.
We're at the top of Cleddon Shoots, a series of waterfalls where the stream falls 550 feet, nearly half a mile, on its way down through Llanlogo to join the River Wye. From here we cross the road again to where the Wye Valley Walk continues through Cuckoo Wood.
I suppose there's not much further to go now, is there?
No, not really. I have a great feeling of anticipation of seeing the Narth again, though. Well, this is a hamlet known as Penny Fan.
How lovely. I understand what you mean now when you said by doing this walk, we'd be escaping into tranquility. Apart from our walks through Tintern and Brockweir, we haven't met a single person on our day's walk. I don't understand it. The Wye Valley Walk is a long-distance footpath. Surely we should have met someone on our way.
Yes, it's surprising, isn't it? It's always been like that around these parts. Although you do see quite a lot of people in the high summer. Anyway, this is where we leave the Wye Valley Walk now. This lane will take us straight into the Narth. I have only to see Auntie Pam's house again, for all the wonderful memories of my time here to come flooding back. How I envied her living in such a place. I wish my visits could last here forever.
Well, she certainly lives in solitude here.
It was some years later, before I realised what an important part the actual walk played in my coming here. It was almost like a preparation for my arrival, which in some way cleansed away all my worries and troubles, so that my mind would be free of all outside influences and distractions, free to become as one with the peacefulness of this wonderful place. That's how it seemed to me, anyway. It could be said that my feelings were intensified by the briefness of my times here, and I really yearned for more, and that may be so, that and a touch of youthful romanticism. Unfortunately though, the time for me to be on my way home would be upon me all too soon.
Yes, it's the ultimate tranquility out here. And I can't let it go to waste. This has got to work as some sort of inspiration, I think. For my college project, perhaps. Yes. Yes, the collected thoughts of our experience here. Why not? It wouldn't make a bad effort. It's just a shame we have to go home now to get our bus.
As we set off down the lane to catch the bus home, I said my farewells to the Narth. As Michael and myself walked along, catching the last glimpses of the place, I thought to myself, "Don't worry, I'll be back."